Previously on Disruptive Pitch.
It is that simple.
Because I mean, that's one of the benefits of public cloud is that it's really easy. You just click, 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 click. You've kind of replicated it.
Yeah.
A little harder than a chewy candy like you would be looking for.
Is the business profitable already? And if not, what's your projections for when it will be?
Basically, we broke even in our first year.
Yeah, there could be some really sensitive photos all over the place that your system could suck up.
I like to shoot. I was raised in Texas, and the partner at the firm loved to shoot. I knew he hired me because of that. We connected.
Contestants from all over the UK have come to pitch their ideas to four of the industry's leading technology specialists. Emerging and startup technology companies have come to London for their chance to have their pitch heard. Judges Neil Cattermole and Andrew McLean from Competitor Cloud will be joined by guest judges each month. But this isn't about delivering just any pitch. It's about who has got what it takes to deliver the perfect pitch.
Hi, how are you doing?
Hi, good, thanks, yeah.
So, what's your name? Where'd you come from?
I'm Alberto. I'm originally from Monza in northern Italy, but I've been based in London for 5 years.
Fantastic. So do you get out and about? Do you do pitching? Have you ever met judges like this before?
This is my first ever pitch outside of university.
Wow.
So no pressure.
I won't hold you up any longer. Okay. Get in there, give them hell, and we'll see you back here afterwards.
Okay, thank you very much. Cheers.
So, first pitch, a big pitch. Let's see how he does.
So, yeah. Hi everyone, I'm Alberto. I'm a co-founder at Gradbase Limited. I wanted to start off today by asking you a very simple question. Who here has ever caught someone or known someone lying on their CV? Please raise your hand. Wow, it seems you're in good company because according to a recent survey by one of the leading education charities, as many as 1 in 3 people have been caught lying on their CV, with 2 out of 3 people knowing someone who've lied on their CV. And do you know why? Because it's really, really easy to get away with this nowadays. 1 in 3 employers does not perform any background checking at all, potentially wasting hundreds of thousands of pounds on employees which are less productive than they thought. And there's a reason for this. University registries make it really difficult for people to verify their graduates' academic qualifications by not enforcing a standard procedure for doing so. Instead, they offer snail mail correspondence and waiting times of up to 4 weeks. But this is where Gradbase comes in. So by harnessing the power of the Bitcoin blockchain technology, Gradbase allows university registrars to upload graduates' data in encrypted form onto a secure and resilient distributed ledger. When this operation is performed, each candidate, so each graduate, will receive in their inbox a custom QR code, such as the ones you see on that CV. The candidates will then be able to put the QR code on near the qualification on their CV. In doing so, they would allow employers in any situation, such as at a careers fair, to instantly and reliably verify the authenticity of the information provided on the CV. So when a QR code is scanned, our logic will look through the blockchain for the original transaction that validated that specific qualification. So with this simple solution, we solve the basic needs of our 3 main stakeholders. Firstly, universities avoid having to waste time and resources by replying to every single verification request. Employers are able to avoid going through painful, lengthy, and expensive verification requests, therefore potentially pushing the background checking earlier in their recruitment process. And finally, candidates are able to add a layer of credibility to their CVs and are therefore able to stand out in favor of people whose qualifications cannot be verified instantaneously. So at the moment, Gradbase is at the MVP stage and we have 1 interested early adopter. The next task is to create, within the next months, a small ecosystem of universities and employers which will be able to prove the product market fit for our service. In 2 years' time, we aim to beat the incumbent and be the main provider, the main way to verify academic qualifications in the UK. So thank you for listening, and I'm ready to answer any questions you may have.
Alberto, very nice pitch, thank you very much. Why did you choose the blockchain as your platform for loading up the CVs?
So, first of all, the blockchain is a public ledger, so it can be accessed with ease. Also, it's the fact that, you know, that the data is not owned by a specific party, but it is encrypted, but in the public domain. So no attacker, like without Gradbase, would be able to go and see the candidate's data. And also, you know, the fact that internal databases are susceptible to like all sorts of breaches, like you've seen the TalkTalk scandal, for example. But the Bitcoin blockchain, one of the very few obvious ways you can, you know, hack the blockchain is by a 50% plus one attack, whereby, you know, malicious users will then keep attaching blocks to the longest chain of the blockchain, which will then become, you know, the malicious.
Oh, blimey, we're getting into a big blockchain tech pitch now. So thank you very much. I understood that. Encryption, security.
Encryption mainly, yes.
Okay.
So for me, it's always this great product, by the way, instantly understood what it is, instantly get the value. Good stuff.
Great.
So the issue is, who's going to pay you for this?
So the business model as it stands would be issuers such as universities would not have to pay. This is because HED, the incumbent, currently does not force universities to pay for the service, as they're a charitable organization. Yet employers would have to then pay a subscription to access X verifications per month.
They're going to really limit its usage if you force it on a subscription basis.
Well, we're pretty flexible at the moment. We could have a subscription basis, or we could have a one-off verification process. But obviously, subscription would be the key way, in our opinion. So we would have a price per verification on the subscription model, which would be less cheaper, obviously cheaper than the one-off verification.
Mm. Okay. Alberto, like it? I understand it. What are the future developments for this? Now, you're talking about CVs, aiming at that target audience of grads. Is there anything else I can upload? Like any of their specific data? Are you planning to do that? Or is it just future employee recommendations or verification?
I mean, look, the blockchain, with blockchain technology, you could submit anything in encrypted form to then prove the existence or the ownership of that particular asset. So we already have kind of a beta for professional qualifications. So work experience. So if someone has worked from this date to that date for a specific company, then that would be then registered on the blockchain. And also certificates, achievements, such as, I don't know, swimming badges or whatever. I mean, and then each of those would correspond to a QR code being released, and this QR code can then be put wherever applicable.
So, Alberto, I've worked in universities for several years. They're quite slow at adopting things.
Yes.
There's a lot of universities. I mean, even in the UK, we're talking over 150. There's a lot of universities, which will have to be trained, will have to implement this system. How are you going to strategically manage to get all those universities on board? Or are you not interested in all universities, just a chunk of them?
I mean, the main risk that we see at the moment is lack of trust in the system, because as you probably know, you must know, registrars are typically kind of like older members of the university staff who are, you know, used to the old school systems.
Yeah.
And then also another guy at the Open University told us at another careers event that, you know, it takes a lot of high level decision making to adopt these. So we would have to create a kind of workshops or go to approach universities and convince them that the blockchain technology is a valuable option. I mean, if it's safe enough for financial transactions, then why shouldn't it be safe enough for, uploading qualifications with very small amounts of Bitcoin?
Fantastic. Alberto, thank you very much.
Thank you.
How was that?
Yeah, I think it went okay.
Yeah, so for your first pitch outside of university, that went?
I was more confident than I thought, so fingers crossed for that, I think.
Good. Well, doing it outside of your natural language as well, I must admit, your English is a lot better than my Italian, so I don't think I'd ever do that. So congratulations, but look, hopefully we'll see you next round.
Yeah, and I hope so too.
Fingers crossed. Thank you very much.
Yeah,
cheers.
Thanks.
Thank you. So,
Another one down, let's get another one in. Hi.
Hi, how are you doing?
Good.
Nice to meet you.
Good, and you?
What's your name and where'd you come from?
Rupert Coney. I'm the co-founder of Clicked.
Fantastic, fantastic. So do you get out and about, do you do much of this pitching? Is this sort of
We're doing increasing amounts of pitching at the moment because we're about to launch our app, so it's really exciting times for us.
Fantastic. So you're pitching to VCs or customers or a bit of
combination,
both?
Angels, VCs, lots of different groups.
Fantastic. So this should be like second nature to you then?
Not quite second nature. I'm used to having a presentation and some notes, but you know, no problem.
Good stuff. Well, look, good luck. Cheers. And we'll speak to you back here after us. Thank you very much. Cheers.
So, another one goes in. Let's see how he does.
Hi there.
Hi.
Hello. Good afternoon.
Well, my name's Rupert and I'm the co-founder of Clicked. It's a creative new app for meeting people and the first of its kind that we believe puts the user fully in control of the matching process. We've got a great new app. We're just a few weeks away from launching the Apple and Android stores. And we think we've proven the concept quite neatly. This is a crowded space, we know that, but we think we've got a great idea. So Clicked is for creative people who know themselves and know what they want. We've designed a simple photo-based mechanism that allows people to define the kind of person that they want in a match and filter people out accordingly. So for example, if someone wants to meet a vegetarian who likes festivals and going to the gym, well, we can do that for them. Or if they want to meet someone who's got more family-oriented values, who likes listening to live music and loves quantum physics, well, we can do that too. We give people the ability to pre-filter according to their own requirements. Before we built the app, we proved the concept. We spoke to about 1,000 people. We did a range of interviews, focus groups, questionnaires. We also built and tested a prototype with around 600 people on the streets of London. Feedback from that was incredible. We had 86% of people really liking the app. We had 90% of single people sign up on the spot. One really interesting turn of events, we started the prototype testing in East London. We did a few days. A week later, we went to Soho, and one guy we stopped said, "Oh, you're that photo-based dating app my mate told me about. Oh, yeah, I like that," which for us blew our mind, but it proved that the concept sticks with people. They like it and they want to talk about it. And in an industry where word of mouth is key to driving growth, it was great news for us. This market is big. It's growing. Since the launch of Tinder in 2009, which was the first app to really gamify the dating market, it's grown 10% year on year. It's now valued at $2.6 billion. It has incredibly low sunk operating and expansion costs. So if you get it right, the opportunity for ROIs and profitability are enormous. It's also crowded, we know that too. But we think it's stale and it's ripe for disruption. We believe our concept does that. When in this industry, word of mouth is absolutely key to driving growth, and first mover advantage is incredibly significant. And if you get those things right, we think you can launch really impressively and go north quickly. So to give you some examples, Tinder, which I mentioned earlier, now is valued at $1.6 billion. Yet it reports to employ between 200 and 300 people only. Happn, the first app to introduce geolocation into the matching process, was valued after 2 years at $800 million. And it generated 22 million users across 40 countries. Coffee Meets Bagel, which was the first to introduce a more female-friendly approach, and purposely took a much slower growth trajectory, was still valued at $400 million within 4 years. At Clicked, we believe we've got the only app that puts the user fully in control of their matching process. We also believe we're going to be the first app that combines the speed and simplicity and fun element of the Tinder-style apps with that serious matching capability of the Match.coms. We've got a great team built around us, and we believe all the signs are pointing in the right direction. And we're now looking for partners to help us disrupt this market in a way that we know we can. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Rupert.
So, Rupert, I think an interesting pitch. Thank you for that. Obviously, as you've mentioned, a saturated market and one where you'll clearly have to differentiate yourself. I think lots of brands out there already driving this. Do you have the... do you think you have the capability to drive that brand awareness? It's a very expensive process, getting the name in front of the audiences.
Yeah.
How are you planning on doing that to scale the business?
It's a tough one. So we are developing at the moment a brand ambassador, an influencer program. We're going to hit the social media market. We're looking for the new up-and-coming influencers in social media, looking at people between 10 to 20,000 followers who want to get behind the next big thing. We're engaging with them at the moment. We're also in conversations with a leading advertising brand, and we're trying to we're going through some negotiations with them to try and get our name on billboards across London in the first few weeks of launch at a minute fraction of the cost. We also think we've got a concept that captures the imagination. When people see it, and we've got people within the industry looking at it, they go, oh, that's neat, that's new, no one's doing that. And because of the nature of the word of mouth and the big churn in this industry, new apps can expect to attract 10 to 20,000 users a month in the first few months, until they then fall off a cliff because they're the same as everything else. We think we're different, and we think that will keep our trajectory going upwards.
Okay. Rupert, hello. Got one question. Why should I use your application other than Tinder?
Yeah. So, do you mind if I give you a slightly longer answer than maybe I should?
Yeah.
Most apps, Tinder started this trend of very quick access to a match, but a poor quality match. You get online quickly and you just judge on superficial values. And then you've got the match.coms up here, which have a much longer process, it's more expensive. But you get a better match. We believe we're taking the best of both worlds. So you don't just match on looks and proximity. When you like the look of someone, you, instead of liking them and waiting for them to like you back, you take a short test that they have designed. Every person gets to design their own three-question photo-based test. So it's using really nice imagery, which people are into from Instagram, and it's a bespoke test. And only when two people like each other and pass each other's test are they a match. So you get a better quality match, you match with someone based on shared interests and common values, and we believe it just gives you that step up without going, oh, I'm going to invest £30 a month, go on match.com, go on OkCupid, take this really seriously.
Is it free?
Freemium app.
Yep.
So it is free, 80% of functionality is free. This is like all of the apps, Tinder as well. It's a subscription-based model we'll use, which we think has been proven to be the most successful. We've got a very competitive price point. We think $4.99 a month is bang on where we should be. And we think the add-on features that you get with our app are much more than others. So we're hoping to break the industry standard, which is a 20% of users pay. We think we can take that north.
Thank you.
Thanks, Richard.
Thank you.
So hi, how was that?
That's good.
Good. I like the little size you came in. Clearly, clearly got a bit of a hard time.
Had a little bit out. No, there's some great questions, interesting questions, good challenges.
Yeah, fantastic. And I think you came across really well, so.
Well, hopefully.
Yeah, well, fingers look good luck in the next round.
Okay.
And fingers crossed we'll
Thanks
see you again.
Thanks very much.
Cheers. Thank you very much.
Bye.
So, that one down. Let's see what else we've got to offer. Hey, how are you doing?
Good, thanks.
Fantastic. Good. So what's your name, where'd you come from?
I'm St. John Hughes. I'm the CEO of Hey Gringo.
Yeah.
Social mobile application, new, just live, and ready to get some traction.
Fantastic. Well, look, do you get involved in pitching? You ever done a competition with judges before?
No, but I've been interviewed and such like, so yeah.
Fantastic. So this should be second nature to you.
Hopefully.
Good stuff. Well, look, go out there, give them hell, and we'll see you back in here afterwards for a bit of a debrief.
Thanks very much. Thanks.
So, another one goes out, let's see how he does.
Hi, my name is St. John Hughes, CEO of Hey Gringo. It's a new, innovative social mobile application. The idea was originally conceived by my co-founders, James Murdoch and Craig Walsh, about 3 years ago, who foresaw a growing need by people for something more than just current social media, which was enabling a lot of connections to be made online, but wasn't translating into more than essentially online communication and information sharing rather than sharing experiences, which for a lot of people's sharing experiences is a lot more meaningful than sharing information. So the idea was to build an application which enabled connections through a format that was really familiar, digital format, but took you to the next level, which was enabling you to connect with like-minded people in person that were around you, that you're not necessarily aware of, or had no other means of finding out who they were or where they were. So the application was developed over a 6-month period, and it released as an MVP, which we then did some user testing on, got some really excellent feedback, and we did some more tweaks to the platform, which enabled us to launch it properly, and it's just gone live yesterday in a proper form. Thank you, thanks. Yeah, really exciting, and looking forward to get some traction with users out there now. We do have a small user base currently, but we're obviously looking to ramp that up in a serious way. Currently launching a major campaign online and a big sponsor of the National Bike Show and Triathlon Show in XL the next 16th to 19th of this month, so the end of the week. Maybe I just run through some key characteristics of that platform may help. It's, as I said, it's a user interest defined platform, so the scope of interests that people can populate on their profile is limitless. Each interest is only limited by a certain number of characters, so 20 characters, but in terms of the number of interests you can add, it's as many as you want, really. And you can switch those on and off at any time, so you can customize your profile at any point in time. So if you go into a particular event or occasion, you may just want to be looking to connect with people on certain things. So you can just switch all the others off and just have those visible. And on the back of that, in reverse, if you're looking to find someone with a particular interest, we've got a filter function, which filters interests. So if you punch in cycling, for instance, on the platform, it'll filter only, it'll give you visibility of just people that have cycling on their profile. And then you can connect with them directly through tapping on the profile, entering in-app chat feature, which allows you to have a conversation online with a view to then connecting with them. And the platform's all about connecting people within 10 miles of yourself. So it brings the real possibility of actually being able to meet with someone, as opposed to a lot of current social media, which is connections all over the place, but actually the possibility of meeting in person is sometimes quite limited because it's just frankly miles away. So the idea was to make it really aimed at connecting people within their community.
So my question to you is this. I ride a bike. I've given at least 4 different apps for free that are social media type apps that allow me to interact with other people. They come with either the products I buy or Zwift or any of these formats that allow me to interact with people. Music, same thing. I collect old books. There's already a free social media website for that. There are local neighborhood type social media apps. I know of 2 that have failed. So tell me about how you've researched these and how you're gonna make money when these guys don't.
Yeah, I mean, I appreciate what you're saying. I think the core difference from ours is that the users define what the scope of the app. I mean, if you've bought a cycling-focused application, and that application is aimed for cyclists, its audience is immediately confined to cyclists or people interested in cycling. Whereas this, you can populate it with whatever interest you want. So the scope of interest is a broader imagination. And that's where we capture, you know, the wider audience. I think that's a core difference with ours. We're giving it the flexibility that people can tailor their profile at any point in time. Personally, from my point of view, I know sometimes I'm going to a particular event, and really, if I'm looking, that event is arranged or organized around a certain activity or business opportunity. And really, you don't necessarily want everyone to see all these other interests of yours. So you just switch those off, and then you can just present those core interests that you want to connect with other people on. So there's that flexibility, which is quite powerful. And then the filtering, because the scope's so large, we had to build in the filtering. And that's where it's powerful. It can just hone down really quickly. And it's when you put in a keyword in the filter function, it's predictive text. So you don't have to type in the exact word. It brings up all the options immediately based on the database of interest that are continuously building up as users populate the profiles.
Sinjin, you mentioned in your presentation, which was great, by the way, thank you. You're going to start by advertising in the bike show, triathletes, outdoorsy types, that sort of thing. How are you going to prevent it from becoming almost like another dating app, just for people within a 10-mile radius of you? There's always that danger of perception, right?
Yeah, I mean, there's a danger of that perception, which we deliberately is making a point of us not being a dating app. But I mean, as I said, because the scope's as broad as the public want to make it, there inevitably possibly will be some people that want to use it to connect for dating purposes, which is fine. But we're certainly not defining it as a dating platform. So where some of the other platforms have, you know, that's the intention, is to connect for dating. I know they're trying to branch out a bit, but their brand is already cemented in the idea of dating, and to get out of that is quite difficult. Whereas we from day one are, this is as broad as you want to take it. So that's where we've come from, really, and very intentionally, though, yeah, person.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Pleasure.
Thank you, Susan.
Thanks.
Good.
Hey, so how do you think that went?
No, really good, thanks. No, very good.
Not very good?
No, very good.
Thanks. Oh, very good,
yeah,
good.
Yeah.
Blimey, I'd be worried then. I thought it went quite well. Oh, fantastic. So,
very pleased.
You think you got the message across? You think they got sort of the purpose of what you're trying to get?
Yes, I think they did.
Good.
Yeah, definitely. I think they can really get the concept, which is really core what's behind this. And we've got it into a format now that people can benefit from wherever they are.
Brilliant, fantastic. Well, look, good luck with the next round, and fingers crossed we'll see you again.
Thanks very much.
Thanks very much. So, another one down. Let's see what the rest of the afternoon has to offer. Hi, how are you doing?
Very well, thanks.
Nice to meet you. So, what's your name and what company from?
I'm Oliver Thomas, I'm the CEO of Disruptive.
Fantastic, fantastic. So you get out and about and do much of this pitching and sort of see?
Not very often, but on and off, especially for funding rounds and so on, I do it.
Perfect. So have you ever been in a competition situation like this?
Never in my life. Looking
good.
Forward.
Well, looking forward to it, that's fantastic. Look, good luck.
Thank you.
Get out there, afterwards come back in here, have a bit of debrief and see how you went.
Thank you so much.
Good luck, thank you very much. Another one goes in, first time. Let's see how he does.
Hello. Hi. My name is Oliver Thomas. I'm the CEO of Disruptive. Disruptive is a platform that connects patients with doctors. And to make it very, very simple, because everybody can identify with the situation of looking for a doctor, it can be a GP, a specialist, a dermatologist, any kind of doctor, even dentists and allied health professionals. And what happens? It works now as it worked 50 years ago. So what happened, you could ask your family, your friends, for any specialist, you get basically the name and a phone number, and you try to ring that person, get an appointment, wait on the phone, and get an appointment maybe in 4 weeks. With Disruptive, these two main processes of finding the right doctor for you and booking an appointment are very simple now. You go on Disruptive, you put in the specialty, the specialist that you want, you can put even the area that you're looking for that doctor, and then your insurance, yeah? And basically you get mini profiles, you get all the doctors that that are working in that area for that specialty that you're looking for. Basically the full profile is where they studied, where they work at, what they specialize on, patient reviews from other patients, and of course also other doctors recommending that doctor. So you can make an informed choice. On top of this, you also have online availability. So you see when that doctor has the next available appointment, you click on that and your appointment is booked. Yeah? All that, which normally takes you days to weeks, depending on your condition, will now only take you less than 60 seconds. We started Disruptive a bit more than 2 years ago. The company has been growing very fast on both sides as a marketplace, on the doctor side, which are our clients, yeah, and then the user side, also potential patients to come on Disruptive. The platform has been live for 18 months right now, and for month to month, we've been growing very, very fast. The revenue model of Disruptive is also very simple. It's a subscription model where the doctors, the clinicians, pay a monthly subscription fee to be part of Disruptive. Why are we doing it this way? It's because we want to incentivize the doctor as well as the patients to use the platform more and more, and we want to promote them to the doctors, the clinicians, to tell the patients, basically all of us, to make the next appointment on Disruptive. The revenue model in a nutshell is for the next years just to maintain the same price, and it's the same price for everybody in Disruptive, We have some special pricing for depending on the specialist, yeah? And then in the future, looking to other possibilities and other, basically, for example, packages, checks to tap into that, into those profit pools. That is Doctify in a nutshell. We've been at the beginning, 2, 3, 4 people working on it. Now we have 30 people in Doctify. We're improving the quality and the added value we provide our clinicians from week to week, so with our tech team, and also we're providing always a better user experience with on the platform for all the potential patients who come and visit Doctify.
Oliver, I could see this working in America where, you know, someone's got a sore foot and they go, I want it done. Really to the plus way for the accent. But in the UK, we're really quite meek when it comes to this. We're used to just going to GPs and being told, 6 weeks, you might get a doctor's appointment, and then you have to go through a set. Yeah. How are you going to educate the people of the United Kingdom to get involved in this different way of doing?
It's a very good question. It's definitely one of the main challenges is how you create first the brand awareness so that everybody knows, and when you're looking for a doctor, that the Doctify solution is available. Yeah, and then the question is there enough added value in the product that we offer, the service that we offer for patients to actually go on Doctify and see, okay, there's a very big difference by doing it the traditional way or doing the Doctify way. So tackling the first one, is there a big difference? Huge difference in terms of time consumption and basically the choice that you make, because we are empowering the patient to make an informed choice. And what has been happening, the outcome of that appointment, yeah, or choosing that doctor is much better. Now, the question that you may ask from a business perspective, how difficult it is to create that brand awareness so that everybody knows that the Doctify solution is available. It's a good question. We have been tackling so far very well. We've been growing very fast in the users. We had last month over 45,000 users just last month. And we have more than 1,000 doctors working on the platform.
It's interesting for me because, I mean, I never go to the doctors as a rule most of the time, well, normally.
Interesting.
and, you know, I may be a little bit out of touch with...
Everything.
if I'm sick, I go to just phone up my local doctor's surgery around the corner and they book an appointment. I just get seen by, could be someone random that I've never met before.
Yeah.
And, oh, yeah, okay, and we do this. Your market audience, I think, you know, we're taking out the whole NHS side of things here. You're talking about private consultants and private medical healthcare, aren't you?
Correct.
Right? In all reality.
Correct. We are talking about the private healthcare market,
yeah.
But more than 80% of our consultants on the website also work within the NHS. Yeah. So basically, you can use Doctify if you have an NHS appointment just to like pre-inform what doctor you're seeing. So for that part, you can work in NHS. We are looking into working in many pilot projects with NHS. There's nothing now. So the core is really the private market and the private appointment that are available on Doctify, yeah.
Okay, interesting.
Oliver, from a brand perspective, why did you choose to rip off a well-known streaming company?
Well,
I like the name.
I think that streaming company has been very successful in providing, basically disrupting an industry, which also didn't move too much. I mean, so basically hardware changing, but it basically digitalized the whole industry, and this is the same thing we're doing. We're just putting digital, what normally did done physically or per phone. So it's very similar in that sense, and I think basically from a brand awareness perspective, I think the brand awareness is very big there, and it's not only Doctify, which is using that name, we see also other successful companies, which I won't name now, but have been very successful in using that. I think the FI thing is something that basically consumers receive as something innovative, something positive, and something they're very happy to engage with.
I like the name and understand the reasoning behind it. I think one of the things for me, doctors changing quite a lot. How do you make sure you're keeping this up to date in real time? I think that's a big, expensive process. What are you going to do to ensure that it's correct, the information?
Yeah, so this is the very interesting part, and the learning curve we've been through the last 2 years is, at the beginning, we offered the service for free just to see with the early adopters, what is the feedback from doctors. And when we started charging doctors for the service, they appreciated the product much more, yeah, and interacted with Doctify much more. And the key thing of Doctify is you engage with doctor, being the doctor himself or the secretary of the doctor. He logs in as you log into LinkedIn or Facebook, yeah? And you manage your profile, you manage your bookings, you manage your reviews. You can like engage with the patients through reviews and emails. So basically, the more the doctor interacts, the more added value he receives from Doctify. So at the beginning, one of the main things we have to make sure of is that the doctors really know how to use the tool and that they use that the tool is very self-explanatory, so they can like explore and explore more. So the more they use Doctify, the happier the client, and basically the more a value they extract from the service. And just to answer your question is, doctors, once they tried it, yeah, they really, really like it. So we don't have any problem with the churn, to be honest. It's just about sometimes doctors don't know all that is available with Doctify. Sometimes we have to teach them even more, and they were surprised for everything that they can make Doctify use for. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much.
So how did they go?
Very well, very well. A little bit nervous, to be honest, but I guess that's what everybody goes through.
Absolutely normal. Yeah. Well, it sounded like you had a really good pitch from here. So.
Oh, thank you.
Fingers crossed. Fingers crossed. Good luck in the next round.
Yeah.
Hopefully we'll see you again. And enjoy. Thank you very much for coming down today.
Thanks for the opportunity.
No problem at all. So another one down. Let's get another one in. Hi there, how you doing?
Hi, good thanks.
How are you? Nice to meet you. So what's your name, where'd you come from?
So my name's Dave Tong and I'm the CTO for MoneyHub Enterprise.
Fantastic. You've had to come far today?
Yeah, from Bristol. So about an hour 45,
Not too bad. I'm guessing you probably spend a lot of time in London.
Every other week or so up here.
Brilliant. So do you get in front of judges much? Do you do out and go, or do you go and pitch much and things like that?
Haven't done anything like this before. We did a big pitch and demo at a fintech conference the other week.
Oh, fantastic. So. Cool. Well, fingers crossed you can take what you said there and go and blow our judges away. So look, good luck, get out there, and we'll see you back in here afterwards.
Brilliant,
Fantastic. Thank you very much. So FinTech conference very recently, let's see if you can take some of those skills into the pitch.
Hi there.
Hi.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. So my name's Dave Tong and I'm the CTO for MoneyHub Enterprise. We're a FinTech company based in Bristol in Southwest England. And we produce financial software for businesses to give to their consumers. So we enable our partners to become true consumer champions. So our software enables customers to bring all their finances in one place. So all their bank accounts, credit cards, mortgages, loans, investments, and put it all into one app. They can also access it on the web as well. So why is this interesting for our businesses that we're selling to? Well, if you take an insurance company, for example, they may only have an annual sort of touch point with their customers. So they may say they have millions of customers, but in reality, they've just sold lots of products. So our platform can help turn those transactional buyers into loyal, engaged customers. And so the value proposition for the end consumers is really bringing all of that data together, which is brilliant in itself, rather than logging into 10 different online banking interfaces. But then we bring insights out of the data and we help people plan for the future. But we're actually just launching our new proactive AI-driven financial assistant. So rather than customers having to log in, go and explore some charts and kind of work out what's happening, we'll bring the information directly to the end consumer. So a few examples of this. Every year in the UK, UK consumers pay about 1.2 billion in penalty fees and charges from their bank accounts. We have algorithms to help detect and predict when a customer is going to hit their overdraft. So we can alert them before that happens and they can stop doing that. So we also have examples, let's say with mortgages. So a customer can put their property into MoneyHub, they can enter their mortgage details in, and we can track their loan to value ratio. So we can kind of alert them when they may be eligible for a much better interest rate on their mortgage. So this is a kind of financial admin that people just kind of put off or don't get around to, but which could save them hundreds of pounds a month. Another example, we can send a nudge to customers if we see that, oh, they've been spending less on eating out this week than usual. Maybe they were ill and they didn't kind of get their usual lunch when they went to work. And we can actually nudge them, would you like to save this money or invest it or put it into your pension? So our product really has a lot of benefit for end consumers, but it really enables enterprise partners, our enterprise partners, to be able to provide an engagement and retention tool for their customers. So they can engage with them on a much more regular basis. It's a value-added service. They can also kind of get some big data trends and analytics from their customer base. So we really believe that it's the proactive artificial intelligence driven nudges and alerts which is really going to kind of take our business forward, though, because relying on customers to regularly log into a money management product, it doesn't always work. You know, finances are complicated, people are busy, but with our kind of nudges, people don't have to. We can send the notifications kind of via a push notification, or we can integrate via API with other services. So we have an example integration with Amazon Alexa, for example, and we can integrate into, you know, whatever channel consumers are already using. So that's kind of the overall nature of our pitch, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
Dave, I have a problem with it.
Yes.
I don't know where to start, really, but I'm ex-financial services myself. And likewise, I agree with, it's very difficult. Banks don't share and they don't want to share. Maybe they could be forced to share, but that's not the problem that I have with this. Problem it has, I have with it, is you've got my information and that's shareable, right? That's a big problem for me. Well, I go and have online banking because I have a PIN Sentry and I have that authentication for that. Maybe I've got more than one bank account, or I've got to do separately. You know, if anything, heaven forbid, that happened to your service, everything I have, from mortgage statements to insurance policies to my banking spend, to everything, is available for someone to see. And let's face it, some of the biggest companies in the world have been hacked very, very easily. How can you convince me to use this?
So you're right. Now, our biggest kind of barrier to end consumers is that trust.
Yeah.
But so that is something that we heavily focus on, and you know we security is incredibly important to us. We go through regular penetration tests, and we make sure that we're operating our service in a secure way as possible. Now, the reality is there'll be some consumers who say I just don't want to share. But actually, the world we're moving to, people are becoming more open with sharing their data. And this is becoming a regulated activity. So when I mentioned about these new APIs, we will need to be authorized by the FCA from January 2018. So there are certain barriers to entry that it's not just kind of, you know, just any one man band down the street can provide this sort of software. There are kind of requirements being put in place around kind of regulation and security that we'll have to meet, which we're actually confident that we can meet those already. So I agree it's a challenge, but actually you'd be surprised at how many people are willing to. And so the example in the States, who are maybe a few years ahead of us, is mint.com, and you know, 10 million customers. So there is scope for this type of data, and especially when these new APIs come in, because customers won't have to share their actual banking passwords. They can kind of authorize a service to access just certain data for a specific time, and they can revoke that access at any time they like.
Hand on heart, I still wouldn't. I've got this bugbear, I hate to say it, I'm sorry guys, but I have a bugbear of that, that because something's convenient, I don't necessarily should be doing this. You know, I would rather not have the convenience and actually do more work to achieve the same result, in the fact that everything I have is in one place, and everything financially in one place, that, you know, that bothers me.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we all have a collective age of Methuselah, but when you read the research, there's a lot of the newer, millennials.
Not you, Andy.
Certainly not me, certainly not me. They don't walk into the banks anymore. Everything they do is online. And, you know, going back to your point, this is very lucrative. We'll re-ask the question, how are you going to stop the big companies coming in on your heels on this? Because it really, I think it's a really cool idea. I just worry that someone's just going to go, that's a great idea.
So banks, you know, have big budgets and they've got, you know, lots of resources, lots of developers. They also have a huge amount of legacy. There are some kind of consultants in the fintech space, kind of called 11FS, and their statement is digital banking is only 1% done. And their point is, okay, yeah, you've got a mobile bank, you know, mobile app from your bank, and okay, great, you know, it's actually good, it has moved on a lot. But banks just at the moment are not set up to operate like a digital first business. They've got so much legacy.
About banks. Just companies. Major global technology companies want this space already. They've already staked their claim here. They're going to own this space.
Well, we believe that there is room for kind of, you know, multiple players in this market. Like I said, there are these different niches. There is also the issue where, some of the kind of really big players, you know, if Amazon or Facebook, you know, kind of wanted to provide this sort of service, then, you know, actually people are a bit more concerned sometimes about the security with an Amazon or a Facebook, whereas, you know, people will invest in, you know, with investment funds from various, you know, small to medium sized companies. In the financial services, there is room for, I think, quite a lot of players in the market. But my point, what I'm saying compared to banks, I think, is that the quality of offering will not just be connecting a few APIs together. If that's all we do, then yeah, we haven't got a chance. But if actually, especially we're a little bit ahead of the market at the moment, we can have these algorithms that can actually help save consumers money.
I definitely see the commercial viability in all aspects. I can see insurance bots trying to sell me policies and all sorts of funky stuff. For me, though, I just don't like the idea of all my data about everything financially in one place. But yeah, I get it. I get it.
Thank you, David.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. So, how do you think that went?
I think it was it's all right. I think the issue we always face up is people are worried about security.
Of course they are.
But the reality is, you know, the judges might not represent kind of, you know, the whole of the UK population.
Yeah, of course.
And so there are certain segments who, oh, this is an issue. But actually there's a vast, large amount of people who, yeah, they're aware of it, but it's not so much of a problem.
Perfect. Well, look, good luck in the next round. And hopefully we'll see you soon.
Thank you very much.
Not a problem at all, not a problem at all. Okay. So another one down, let's bring in the next one. Okay, nice to meet you, how are you doing?
Nice to meet you, Dave, how are you?
Very good, thank you, very good, very good. So what's your name and where are you from?
I'm David, I'm a founder of Wallscope.
Fantastic. So do you get involved in much of this pitching? Do you get out in front of VCs and people? Or?
We've been doing a lot recently. We've been pitching to the public sector in Scotland.
Fantastic.
And we've been pitching at some aspects with people involved in retail data as well.
Brilliant. So do you get involved in any competitions like this at all?
No, this is the first one this year.
Funny enough, a lot of our people have said that. Well, look, good luck. Go out there. Make sure those judges get your idea across. And we'll see you back in here afterwards.
Thank you very
much. Fantastic. So another one goes out to see our judges. Let's see how he does.
Hey, good afternoon.
Hi, good afternoon.
Hi. Good afternoon. I'm David, founder of Wallscope. We're interested in how organisations can better join their data, particularly unstructured data, so we can produce new interactive analytics and visualisations by joining data which previously was not joined. We use semantic web techniques and linked data principles. We do not have to replicate the data, we just create a rich meta layer as an RDF, which we can use can be delivered through our API, it can be used for multiple application development, we can produce rich dashboards, we can improve the workflow across content management systems, digital publishing, and it really helps people and reduce that data analyst task of joining data together, which can take quite a lot of time and is actually one of the most boring parts of data analytics. And we've been working recently with the National Health Service in Scotland to look at how they can improve their flow and reporting of data. This is a very critical area because you can make improvements on prescribing, procurement, fraud detection, know your customer, due diligence, freedom of information requests, and many others. Recently, we've also been working with retail data, doing a pilot project, looking at how we can build the foundations of aggregating data and allowing retailers to compare that and bring other data sources in. So we can work with multiple data sources to improve many areas across the digital publishing workflow.
Thanks, David.
Thank you.
A very well-known, very large management consultancy company, I think, tried to do this with the NHS some time ago, to do with patients and appointments or availability for operations, for argument's sake. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, they ran out of money before the project was completed. Interestingly, what sparked my understanding of it is when you're working with the NHS to do that, something very, very similar. I mean, this was going back years ago. For one, that's going to take an age to do. You know what they're like. But What type of data are you linking? Is the linking of data that's freely available now, or is it any data that I can give you that you link to any data that I give you that I know about over there, or how does that work?
We can link to multiple data sources. We could link to a database, we can read off from PDFs, document stores, and what's been interesting to NHS is this kind of multiple spreadsheets lying around, but what we can do is actually link and actually allow reasoning and factoring between each of the data points in each individual spreadsheet, and allow that. This is where we get a new analytics perspective on what they're doing that also reduces the cost of time for people actually having to produce multiple spreadsheets, work into them. We create a universal templated approach. It's very dynamic and it's very efficient use of time.
So you jumped between NHS and digital media, and there are probably other areas that you could apply this. What I see so far with data analytics companies today is either I'm a specialist in presentation of data and I'm working with a large cloud service provider or storage company as their data analytics partner, or I'm very vertically oriented around something, say smart metering or NHS or graphical recognition. What's your niche, or do you have one of these large partners who's going to drive you to market?
We our software is essentially agnostic. The interest we have from the NHS is comes from some work we did in Scotland where we're asked to look at this as a problem. We are not necessarily driven by NHS, but we're driven by the concept of joining data between multiple agencies and also sharing within an organisation. So we can apply this within the use of vocabulary, which is a semantic piece which allows the classification at a machine level of different data points which are not normally made available. So we can train that system towards the financial sector, we could train it towards IoT objects. It doesn't really matter to us because it's all about joining. The visualization, plenty of people can do that, we know. The challenge we've answered is actually joining the data ahead of the visualization and making that available for different level of analytics.
Maybe I'm saying it wrong. So you're in the end, you need to make money out of this. I could ask you, did you deliver value to the NHS and did the NHS pay you enough money to make it profitable for you? But that's really not worth asking. The reality is that you've got to get access to the customer. And so you either become a specialist in a sector, you get known for that, or you have someone who's pushing data sets at you and asking you to solve these problems. You need the access to those customers who can pay that money for what you do. How do you get them?
What we've been working on is a development of an appliance, so we can work with channel partners to deliver our software within our appliance concept, which can be dropped into a data center, it could be on-premise, it could be delivered through the cloud, but our route to market we see is through channel partners who are close up with companies already have an investment in data. We add a layer which is a semantic layer, and to us it might be how we take something like a data lake and something like Hadoop and add a semantic layer on that. So we're not aiming to be specialists in the analytics. What we've been aiming to be specialists in how we can join and save the time in joining the data. And in that sense, we're agnostic about the data. As long as it's available to the system, then we can report it out and make that available through our API.
So channel. So you're proving some direct sales to prove the point, then you want to go to channel.
We want products, we don't want to offer services. Inevitably where we are as a business, there's aspects of consultancy which people are asking us about because they actually welcome our experience. But at the end of the day, we want customers, not clients, and we'd rather deliver through channel partners.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Evan. Thank you. Brilliant. So it sounded very, very positive.
Thank you for that.
Did it go very positively?
I felt very comfortable doing that. We've been out speaking to a lot of people about this recently.
Exactly.
I'm in an interesting space to come in and do that.
What can I say? I'm pleased to hear it.
It's been recorded, which is, I'll be able to watch it.
Good. Well, look, it sounded great. So fingers crossed you'll get through to the next round. But look, if not, lovely to meet you. Thank you for your time. And good luck.
Thank you for that, dude.
Thank you. Cheers. Bye. So another one down. Let's bring on the next victim. Hi there, how are you doing?
Hi, very well, thank you.
Nice to meet you. What's your name and where'd you come from?
So I'm Martin Campbell, I'm the co-founder and managing director of Ormsby Street, the company behind Credit HQ.
Fantastic. So do you get out and do much of this? Do you get in front of many VCs? And
yes, we've been pitching at the moment for our latest round of funding. So fantastic. Doing lots of pitching with VCs and also some big trade events. FinTech is our field. And so brilliant. A lot of interest there from banks and all sorts of organisations. So
yeah, so this will be second nature to you. Places. Good. Well, look, don't let me hold you up any longer. Get out there, wow the judges. And we'll see you back here afterwards for a bit of a debrief.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. See you. So another one goes into the judges. Let's see how he does. And well, fingers crossed. Sounds like a pro.
Giving you a present.
Oh, wonderful. For it's us. Nothing we can eat. Is it?
We're a bit hungry. I'm afraid not. We don't have that sexy product. Thank you. I just need to give you a bill.
Oh, wonderful.
The good news is you don't need to pay this bill, but it's just a little bit of a kind of aid memoir about how day-to-day business kind of works. So I'm Martin Campbell. I'm the founder and managing director of Ormsby Street. We're the company behind Credit HQ. And our mission in the world is to help small businesses take control of their cash. Most small businesses that trade business to business do so by issuing invoices just like the one that I've just given you. And just like the one that I've just given you, most of those invoices are issued on 30-day terms or very similar. Would anybody like to hazard a guess as to when the average business, small business, can expect to be paid its 30-day
invoice? 60 days. Five.
Probably 90.
50 days, sort of.
You're not far off. The average is 71 days. Yeah. Unfortunately, the extremes are really extremes. If you invoice certain companies, which shall remain nameless, you can expect to be paid over 100 days after your invoice was due.
Yeah, I wouldn't expect a Disruptive pitch to be paying this anytime soon.
No.
Your checks in the post.
This is a huge issue. Obviously, for small businesses, access to finance is often very limited, and so they're reliant on cash flow to actually pay the bills, to keep investing, to hire new staff, actually to pay keep the electricity on and pay the staff at the end of the month. My history is in small business. I started my first small business while I was still at college. I grew a small web agency to be a leader in its field. But throughout the period that I was growing it, although I was dealing with household brand names, I was continually having to chase them for invoices. And I was continually having tens of thousands of pounds, which should have been invested in my business, sitting in their bank accounts because they were paying late. So that's what inspired me to set up Ormsby Street and to really tackle this problem head on with our product, Credit HQ. Now, what Credit HQ does is seeks to put the small business back in control of its own cash by giving small business leaders the three things that they absolutely need in order to make good decisions and take good actions around cash flow. Now, those three things are: they need data. They need to know who's likely to pay them late, who's a risky customer to deal with, who do they really need to actually pull back from trading with if they're already trading with them, or avoid if they're just getting started. That data is really valuable. It comes from companies like Experian and like Dun & Bradstreet, like different companies around the world who typically sell that data to larger businesses but have no route and no viable product really for the small businesses that we want to help. But data on its own is not going to be enough, so we also need to provide a set of tools. And what those tools do is give the small business the instant on-screen information that they need when they're dealing with a new customer. So for example, I take a phone call, I look up a customer, I see some colour indicators like this that say good risk, might be a little bit slow on payment, but really not too bad. I know right away that there and then on the phone I can offer you a good price and I can put you on my typical invoicing terms. If I see some red on that report, I know straight away that I'm going to ask you for some cash up front and that I'm going to limit your credit terms so that I don't get too exposed to you. So really, really simple decision-making tools, but very powerful ones. I can also, if I get into a customer situation where they're overdue with me, I can issue a letter before action directly from my solicitor with a few clicks in the app. I don't have to go and sit down with a solicitor and pay £450 and issue a court proceeding and do all that in a few clicks from wherever I happen to be and get on with running my business.
So I'm assuming this is a subscription-based service, so you just need to grow the number of subscribers.
That's right. We have a freemium-based platform, so we're able to offer a certain tier of data completely free, which gives you a taste of the platform, actually unlocks the power of, actually, I didn't realize that customer might be a little bit risky. I better find out more. And then our objective is to get you to sign up to the subscription product. That's absolutely right.
Okay. So you got to tie in to all the different billing systems. And it sounds like you got to do some tie in to lawyers as well. What if my lawyer is really small? Maybe it's my sister. Or what if I'm not actually using a billing system, but I'm using Google Docs?
Absolutely, you may well be using Google Docs, and the majority of our customers are actually entering their invoice data directly into our platform at the moment. For us, the cloud-based accounting tie-ins are very new, we've just launched that. The big power for us, obviously, is although it takes a slightly higher commitment from a customer to link us up, the quantity of data that we get access to enables us to give them a much richer experience. But you don't have to be using one of those platforms in order to use the product. Most of our customers are not. In terms of the lawyer tie-in, and there are other tie-ins in the product as well, we've tied into our particular lawyers. There are two law firms that we tie into. So we have a panel, we're able to make sure that we're always able to deliver the services for you. If you wanted to do those services directly elsewhere, you could. You wouldn't be able to do that within the product. The difference would be included in your subscription of perhaps £25 a month with Credit HQ. You could issue a number of those letters before action. If you go to a solicitor, maybe not your sister, but a solicitor to ask for that service, you'll pay hundreds of pounds to do it. So it's a very, very cost effective way because we've been able to automate the process and make sure that it flows very, very smoothly.
So, I think good presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. Very relevant. I mean, clearly, small businesses, one of the biggest issues is cash flow, return on capital employed, and days payable, and days receivable, and those factors. You talked about 30,000 users. How many of them today have paid for the upgrade?
It's just under 6,500 of those users have upgraded to the paid platform, and conversions continue.
Around about 20%.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Great.
Thanks, Mark. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Very much.
Thank you.
I'll leave you to pay those invoices that you're late.
90 days from us.
Yeah. Hi, how did it go?
Hello, I think it went very well, thank you.
Good.
Yeah,
well,
as well
really
as
pleasant.
You can tell.
Yeah, so you think you got the message across?
I think I did. I think the judges really seemed to pick up on some of the kind of logical next steps for us, which is always a good sign. You always know you've communicated what you're doing.
Definitely.
If somebody says, are you going to do this next? And you can say, yeah, absolutely, that's where
Fantastic.
We're headed.
Well, look. Fingers crossed you get to the next round, and if so, we'll see you back soon.
But no,
thank you for coming down, really appreciate it.
Many thanks.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
So, another one down. Let's see what the last few have to offer. Hi there, how are you doing?
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you too.
So what's your name and where did you come from?
Oh, I am Zdeněk from UK1, and we bring a new universal key for the web.
Wow. Well, that sounds absolutely fascinating. Well, I mean, don't tell us too much now because you've got to pitch to the judges.
Great.
But I'm interested to know, do you get out and do this often? Do you get out and sort of pitch and sort of see VCs and things like that?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, cool. And do you ever get involved with this? Have you ever been in a competition before where you've had to be judged on your pitch and how you can do it?
Yeah, I'm not so prepared, so I hope it will be good. So
well, look, do you know what? Get out there.
Yeah.
Give
Thanks.
Them hell and let's see how it goes. Fantastic.
Thank you.
So, not very prepared. We shall see if he can pull it out of the bag.
My name is Zdeněk Heffler and I am a proud founder of a cybersecurity startup called UK1.
Did you say broke founder?
Proud.
Oh, proud. Sorry.
I'm so proud. UK1 is a free social login aggregator. With the mission to enhance security on the web. And we do it by offering unified secure solution to log into websites. What is absolutely exciting, as a side effect, UK1 improves user experience and acquisition. Let me tell you a few numbers, exactly four numbers. Only 20% of websites offer any social login option, but 77% of users believe that social logins should be offered by any website. And 86% of users are being bothered by having to create new accounts. 54% of users 54%, I'm sorry for my English, 54% of users are rather leave website because of that. So now imagine you have a website, for example e-commerce, and you need authenticate users to allow them access to more private data, for example list of orders. So, please come with me. What do you need to care about? So you need the registration form, login form, data validation, email verification, password and data protection. And perhaps you would like to use also Facebook login, Google, LinkedIn, etc. So YuKey 1 simplifies this because only thing you need is 20 minutes to integrate YuKey 1 SDK, and you will get a secure and powerful solution to log into websites. And so, as you can see, YuKey 1 helps to save a lot of development time, and also, what maybe it's more important, it will offer you to catch more users, to increase the number of registrations.
Where's the revenue?
Basic implementation is free because we would like to, you know, improve security on the web, because 90% of the webmasters and developers, they don't care about security, they still use MD5 hashes. So basic implementation is free. It means as a website, you can get five data from user. It means country, language, name, email, and image. That's it. But users are able to uncheck, unselect for example, email and image. So as a website, you are not sure if you will get this information. So we will have one-time cost premium model, which will be able to offer, you know, we sell it something like a required option. So you will be able to get email and images too, if you want. And then we would like to offer more premium features like, like analytics tools, branding options, and so on.
I think there'll be some people watching this pitch and they'll think, this is just really stupid. This just isn't working. There's a million things out there. But actually, you've got the roots of something quite cool. If you're saying that you're almost creating a PayPal of login, as in instead of worrying about, you know, PayPal came into the thing because people needed to pay for things, but they didn't want to just put their bank details on, PayPal came along. And there's a lot of these login things, but if you've got a mechanism to start creating things like financials so that you can have billing addresses, proper secure data, and it's a universal login, that's something. But I think you need to work on the catch, because at the moment it comes across a bit like just every other WordPress plugin or every other little app that's out there. But if you're doing what I think you're doing, I think you have something really cool. But I think you need to work on the pitch and then you'll have it.
Yeah, I know. Thank you.
Great. Brilliant. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Zenit.
Have a nice day.
And Jay.
So,
hey.
How did that
again?
How'd that go?
Yeah, it was pretty cool. It was exciting, but I was a little bit nervous, you know, because of my English. And
it's fine.
Yeah, this is really new for me. So, yeah, I hope it will be good for judges.
Well,
but for me, it was great. Look, great experience.
Did you enjoy it?
Yeah,
that's
definitely.
Look, good luck in the next round.
Thanks.
Fingers crossed, we'll see you again. Thank you very much for your time. Thanks for coming down.
Bye.
So, another one down. Let's get another one in. Hi, how are you doing?
Hi, I'm good, thank you.
Nice to meet you. What's your name and where'd you come from?
I'm Tom. I'm originally from London. We're basically presenting today about AdSnap, which is a mobile application that I've sort of had a concept of for a while.
Cool.
Recently started building.
Fantastic. So do you get out and talk about your idea much, or...?
Actually, this is, apart from our kind of conversations with kind of advisors and kind of agent investors, this is my first pitch.
Fantastic. Well, look, good luck.
Thank you very much.
Get out there, give them hell, and we'll see you back in afterwards.
Thanks very much indeed.
Fantastic. Good luck. So, first pitch. Let's see how he does.
Hi there.
Hey, Tom.
Hey, Tom. Hi. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Lovely to meet you all. It's
firstly, it's a pleasure to be here. We've had such an interesting afternoon. Genuinely, it's been fantastic. And I'm really, really excited to talk to you about the application that we've been building over the last 6 months or so. It's aimed at people under the age of 30, and it's called AdSnap. So about 6 months ago, I approached my friend with an idea that I'd had for a while. And I asked him if he would do the honor of building it with me. And 6 months later, standing here, we now have another co-founder based in Hamburg, and we have a prototype for iOS and Android, which we will roll out to the wide world in a couple of months. AdSnap, from a user's perspective, is a mobile application that allows users to collect discounts by photographing real-world branded advertising. But behind it, AdSnap is actually a data analysis engine. So we collect a number of really, really core, interesting data points. So we use image recognition software, which never fails to impress me, in order to collect. So we know where or what's in a photo when someone takes a photo of it. We collect location data, which lets us know where the photo is taken. We collect a number of user demographic points, which show us kind of the finer details of what a user is doing. And we know exactly where someone's redeemed a discount code. And we do all of that for kind of four key groups. So brands, advertising agencies, media agencies, and advertising real estate owners. And it's kind of from those kind of four key groups that we will look to derive our revenue. The app, of course, will be free for users. As a kind of a number of additional features to AdSnap, we're also a trading platform, which I think is pretty cool. So we allow our users to multiply the value of their discount. It depends obviously on the retailer and the client, but we allow them to multiply their discount by trading them with other users on the platform and by sharing them on social networks. So in doing so, we take offline advertising and put it online. And we also increase the engagement between the user and the brand and the user and the advertising agency. We also have a number of kind of other features, which include things like leaderboards and treasure hunts, which basically just add layers of gamification to the application. And the kind of target markets the use case scenarios rather that we kind of see this working in include things like working with a beer company at a music festival, working with a number of retailers in shopping malls, in town centres, or working with a kind of a promoted campaign at, say, a conference up and down the country.
You said that was the main thing you're looking to do, is measure the effectiveness of online offline advertising. Offline.
So real world advertising,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So at stations or on the street or bus stops or wherever, right?
Exactly.
You also said that you've got this ability to sell or trade your discount vouchers.
Yeah.
So are you an advertiser by spreading the word, or are you? I'm just worried you've got dual purpose here and you might get confused as to which one you're going to focus on.
Fair. First and foremost, we want to collect the data and analyze it and feed it back to our brands, our advertising agencies, our media agencies, and the real estate owners themselves. The trading aspect is more a gamification layer to ensure that users stay on AdSnap, so they're on it all the time. And we want to create layers, if you will, of value. So say, for example, you take a photo of, I don't know what brands you like.
Don't go there.
How can I guess? Jaguar Land Rover, for example. And I take a photo of, I don't know, Long Lines, I think was a good example of a watch earlier. We can trade it. And when we trade it, a multiplier is applied. So depends on the brand, of course, but say our discount is worth 10%. It's then worth 12%. And that kind of layer of gamification keeps people on the app, essentially. But it's very much an addition rather than what our core goal is, yes.
Well, I guess I thought you were originally thinking of it as a value for the end user, which, yes, it is, but the reality is it's a value for the campaigner. So you allow them to create campaigns that involve multiple touch points as opposed to one to hit that magic seven eyeball hits gives me permanent retention.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But so where we will really add the most value is between the four layers, because you've got the kind of real estate owners at the bottom, so So you've got JC DeCal and Clearwater. There aren't very many of them. You've got more and more media agencies on top of that layer who buy the space off them and then rent it to the advertising agencies. And you've got the advertising agencies who create the campaigns for the brands, and thousands of brands, hundreds of thousands of brands. And at each layer, we will sell a different kind of data, because people will be in interested in different things. For the advertising agencies, they want to see how effective their campaign is, so that they can quantify it and show the brands, hey guys, we're pretty fantastic. For the media agencies, they want to know that they're getting the right price for their advertising space. And so a good example that was used earlier was that, you know, you might have a piece of advertising Adidas advert, for example, up on Holborn Circus that costs 100K. But how do you actually know, how do Adidas know they're actually getting 100K's worth of value out of it? They could be getting 2.5 million pounds value out of it, or they could be getting, you know, 100 quid. There's no way of telling until now. And so that's what we do for them. And then the real estate owners, they want to know where the most valuable stuff is, what they own that's valuable, and where other valuable space is.
Fantastic way of blending old world, old school advertising with, you know, latest disruptive technologies.
Thank you.
Very interesting.
Tom, you know, real world measurement of advertising for ROI for marketing. I get that. What I'm trying to think of is, for example, use the analogy, say Nike are advertising the latest trainer, Elk Circus. Who is actually monitoring that advert is in Oxford Circus? How do you pick that up? I can get you're running analytics in the background of who's buying what trainers in what region.
Yeah.
But how do you tie that up to offline advertising? Are you going around someone taking pictures, or you're monitoring guys in the background?
The users are taking pictures.
What if they're not taking pictures?
Well, the whole thing works on the back that they want to take pictures because they want to get the discount.
But it's wholly reliant.
Is that right?
Yes, that's right.
I'd say, so they're incentivized at getting a discount of taking pictures of that brand in that location.
So we'll also have maps. So users will be able to see where there are billboards that are relevant to them.
So it's like Pokemon. They'll be hunting them.
Similar, yes. Yeah. One of the layers that we add is treasure hunts.
They lost us.
So if you have a particular, you know, if a brand 30. Has a particular thing they really want to sell, we'll create a treasure hunt for it.
Every couple of months, I get a text, not a WhatsApp, a text from my father, and he says, son, your mother and I want to take you for dinner. So we go out to dinner, and he always chooses a restaurant, and he always produces, at which point I cringe and want to die, the voucher code. Say. He pulls it out, and he goes, and he shows it to the waitress, and I go, oh, Christ. Now, I get why you've aimed this at the under 30s, but isn't this the market with the least amount of disposable income? Why have you, what was your logic behind aiming this at under 30?
Oh, and the most pride.
And the most, in my case, but I'm sure when I'm my father's age, I'll be also producing the piece of paper.
My parents did that too. But I would argue that you've kind of answered the question yourself.
You have.
They don't have the most disposable income, so they're going to be the ones looking for deals.
The gamification is perhaps the big item, and I think that perhaps needs to be the prime function in front, which is, you know, someone might go shopping in a shopping mall, Westfield. So Westfield campaigns with all of the tenants on, let's create a campaign, and if the client does X visits, footfall traffic, 20 visits as opposed to the average of 10, we give them something. And everybody piles in, you create the campaign.
Well, I mean.
And that's the enablement you could run for Bicester Village, Westfield, et cetera. I get that. It's just, do you want to be the brand that's in front? You've got to download this app and use it. Or do they build your technology?
Do they white label our technology for themselves? We think that the value really lies in the data. From the people we've spoken to and some of the people we spoke with earlier, they're interested in what we can offer them. And the gamification layer is fantastic, and I really like it. But I think it's more a strategy to keep users interested.
That's why it's for the under 30s. Yeah. We don't get gamification.
Yeah. I think it's great that you can demonstrate an ROI to a marketing campaign to large corporates.
Thank you.
They've been desperate to do that, and it's very difficult to prove an ROI for that. I think that's a good idea.
Thank you.
So, how'd they go?
Yeah, really well.
Good. Yeah. Good, good, good. So for your first time, do you feel that you got into it and got into the swing of
things? Yeah, I really enjoyed it. Good. It's been a fantastic day, actually. And it's great to hear the feedback as well. And criticism really only builds successful businesses, ultimately.
100%. Yeah. Well, fantastic. Well, look, really great to see you.
Thank you very much indeed.
Good luck with the rest of the program.
Thank you.
And good luck with the product in the future.
Thank you very much
indeed.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
Have a lovely day.
So that's it. Now it's our judges' chance to have their deliberation and figure out exactly which two are going to go into Team Neil and Team Andy to win a chance to pitch at the live final at Cloud Expo Europe in March. Okay, hi and welcome back to the final bit of this particular episode of Disruptive Pitch, and this is obviously the bit where we decide who goes on to Team Neil and who goes on to Team Andy. So guys, who wants to start with a bit of a rundown on who we saw?
Well, there was, again, some fantastic and some okay pitches. We base these things on the quality of pitches, not necessarily the technologies themselves. I like Doctify, Money Hub, Wallscope, Ormansby, AdSnap. They were all really good pitches.
I'll tell you what, to be honest with you, it's going to be come down to two or three. Wallscope, because I like it, really. I like appliance-based analytics, really. Ormansby Street, love it. Why? Because they're focusing on the SME marketplace, and also they do some quite funky stuff with cash management, cash flow management, and AdSnap. I like that too, actually.
Yeah, so despite the fact it wasn't even really fully built yet, I thought his concept was was quite clever.
Gamification. It's interesting. It'll be very interesting how he gets on.
Cool.
So based on the other judges and what we've just discussed, AdSnap.
AdSnap.
AdSnap is one.
Congratulations, AdSnap.
Congratulations. And then our second winner, it's Ormansby Street.
Congratulations, Ormansby Street.
Yeah, let's give him a round of applause.
Well done. Well done.
So anyway, all it leaves for me to say is goodbye from
me.
And goodbye from
me.
And goodbye from me. And we shall see you live on the 15th of March. See you then. Thank you very much.
Thank you.